Welcome, dear viewer, to this production on Discovering Darwin, a historical review. My name's Don, and I spent the month of September in 2007 in a caravan, the Hidden Valley Tourist Caravan Park. It's quite a lovely park with the main advent here, a pool, and a picture of my caravan. The first people in the area were the Larrakia Aboriginal people, who were the original inhabitants and traditional owners of Darwin and the area. These people had a coastal affiliation and derived much of their livelihood from the ocean and waters of the region. Greatly celebrated throughout Darwin many plaques and monuments. He represented South Australia, spent his life searching for a route from South Australia through to the north to find rich, fertile country and a trade route to Asia. He broke through in 1864 and rather 1862, and in 1864, the Northern Territory of South Australia was created. He left Adelaide in October 1861 and arrived at Chambers Bay in July 1862. A plaque celebrating his initials on a tree in 1867. There are many statues to commemorate his achievement. By the year of the 1870s, the settlement of Darwin was underway. This is an original woodcut. Darwin rapidly became an important shipping port. In 1885, a new wharf was constructed at Stokes Hill to be a terminus for the new North Australian Railway. The new wharf was damaged by the 1897 cyclone and was reconstructed in 1904. This wharf was bombed the first day at air raid by the Japanese, 19th of February, 1942. The original 1885 wharf. The railway line is clearly apparent. The railway was used for many purposes, including shipping cattle from the interior. The wharf was the center of an active trade and pearling industry. From 1871, quite large vessels sailed up the Roper River with materials for the building of the Overland Telegraph construction. Later, boats supplied the stores, which created new towns of Roper Bar and Borroloola. From the 1880s, boats took station supplies around the coast. They bought back cargoes of wool and cattle. The first Chinese migrants came to the Darwin area, or Palmerston as it was called, in 1874 from Singapore. Their numbers rapidly increased as they were used in the gold mining industry, and they came to outnumber the whites 10 to 1. With the takeover of the Australia by the Commonwealth government in 1901, the White Australia policy forbade the migration of new Chinese migrants. A Chinese migrant with his cart and water buffalo. The Chinese were noted market gardeners, some worked as servants, and many ran stores. Chinese stores in downtown Darwin. A Chinese market garden. There are many of these at Dr. Skilly. Chinese dwellings that are recorded as having been condemned. Legacy. Pearl shells were discovered in Darwin Harbour in 1884. For almost 80 years, Port Darwin was the basis for a significant pearling fleet, which worked the harbour bed and outside waters. This important industry brought people from different places, such as Japan, Philippines, Malaya, Timor, Thursday Island, as far afield as Greece. A pearl lugger in Darwin Harbour. Pearl diving using a hard helmet. Following the completion of the Overland Telegraph in 1872, pastoralists traveled overland from Central Australia. In the 1880s, there was a substantial rush for grass, with overlanders bringing 200,000 cattle and setting up vast new stations on the Barkly Highlands, the Gulf and Victoria River districts, as well as the Darwin hinterland and the Kimberleys. The Overland Telegraph line, which was later connected to Java and to the rest of the world, was completed in 2 years at the immense cost of £500,000. It was completed in 1872 from Port Augusta over 3,000 kilometers to Darwin and later extended under seas. The erection of the first pole. An early construction camp for the Overland Telegraph. Completion of the telegraph line. It's hard to measure the immense importance of this line, which led to instant communication and the entry of Darwin into the modern world. The telegraph station in Darwin. These were quite substantial structures because they had to house trained men and their families. The completion of the telegraph line in 1872 through largely unexplored and difficult terrain rapidly led to the creation of the track, a trail that led from Alice Springs to Darwin, and which was used by the overlanders and their cattle. A picture of the early track in the foreground. I think eventually it may have become the Stuart Highway. Keep in mind that the track was not an all-season road. Although most people are familiar with the damage caused by Cyclone Tracy in 1974, which devastated vast sections of Darwin, not many people know the extensive damage caused by the 1897 cyclone that also leveled many buildings. Investment and prosperity. By the late 1890s up to 1897, a gold rush in the interior and the growing cattle industry led to great prosperity in the Darwin area. Sadly, this was the decline. Political instability in Asia led to the migration of many Greeks. Some worked in the furthering industry, others on the railway. By 1918, there were over 200 Greek settlers living in Greek town. An early Greek Orthodox church constructed by the Greek community in Darwin. Greek migrants. Sponge fishermen also migrated from Greece and settled in Darwin. Many came from the Greek islands, not sure how to say it, Klimnos, pointed out here. Because of the close connection between Darwin and this Greek island, the people of the island donated a statue to Darwin and set up a sister city status. This statue, situated along with the bronze plaque, called the Great Pot of Water, symbolizes the hard work of a Greek mother in supporting her family. It's erected in Darwin in 1985. The North Australian Railway development was a critical part of the development of the city. Commenced originally to join Adelaide and Darwin, this didn't occur until just recently, but it did succeed in reaching the goldfields of Pine Creek and servicing the local cattle industry. The railway served a critical part in the Second World War in transporting military supplies to Darwin was defense against the Japanese. It was eventually unprofitable and shut in 1976. The 19th of February 1942 could be a day that lives in infamy for people in Darwin, with the dropping of more bombs on Darwin by a Japanese invasion force than was dropped on Pearl Harbor. Sections of the city were leveled by the use of such things as incendiary bombs. First, the many Vietnamese boat people arrived in Darwin in April 1975 and traveled 3,500 kilometers from communist Vietnam. The voyage was typical, the experience of more than 2,000 Vietnamese boat people who arrived in Darwin in the next 10 years. Most were allowed to remain in Australia. Some chose to remain in Darwin. There were also substantial numbers of East Timorese refugees. Refugees fled the fighting for independence, and many sailed to Darwin. Make new homes there. Timorese refugees, the cause of the problem was the withdrawal of Portugal from the colony in 1975 and the invasion by Indonesia and subsequent fighting. These are some, but by no means all, the bronze plaques that are embedded in the pavement in the main shopping mall of Central Darwin. It provides a succinct and useful overview of some of the main themes of Northern Territory history. Thanks, dear viewer, for joining me on this review. Pictures are from Pictures Australia on the web, which include the Australian Military Museum and the Northern Territory Museum. Have a good day.